We now turn to polymers of amino acids, that is, peptides and proteins. Biologically occurring polypeptides range in size from small to very large, consisting from 2 or 3 amino acids to thousands of linked amino acid residues. Our focus is on the fundamental chemical properties of these polymers. 2 amino acid molecules can be covalently joined through a substituted amide linkage. This is termed as a peptide bond, and it yields a dipeptide. Such a linkage is formed by removal of the elements of water, in other words, dehydration, from the alpha carboxyl group of one amino acid and the alpha amino group of another amino acid. This is why the peptide is said to consist of not just amino acids, but amino acid residues. That is, what is left over after water has been removed from them collectively. So, another way to look at it is that the peptide bond formation is an example of a condensation reaction because water is obtained as a byproduct. Under standard biochemical conditions, the equilibrium for the reaction shown here favors the amino acids over the dipeptide. 3 amino acids can be joined by 2 peptide bonds to form a tripeptide. Similarly, 4 amino acids can also be linked to form a tetrapeptide and 5 to form a pentapeptide, and so on. When a few amino acids are joined in this fashion, the structure is called an oligopeptide. When many amino acids are joined, the product is called a polypeptide. Proteins may have thousands of amino acid residues. Although the terms protein and polypeptide are sometimes used interchangeably, molecules referred to as polypeptides generally have molecular weights below 10,000 daltons, and those called proteins have higher molecular weights. Let's take a look at the structure of a pentapeptide closely now. As already noted, an amino acid in a peptide is often called a residue, that is, the part left over after losing the elements of water, specifically a hydrogen atom from its amino group and a hydroxyl moiety from its carboxyl group. In a peptide, the amino acid residue at the end with a free alpha amino group is called the amino terminal or N-terminal residue. The residue at the other end, which has a free carboxyl group, is called the carboxyl terminal or C-terminal residue. So, how does a peptide bond form exactly? Let us take a look at the mechanism now. In a growing polypeptide chain, we know that there is an amino or an N-terminal and a carboxyl or a C-terminal. The carbon at the carboxyl end is slightly electropositive because of oxygen's high electronegativity. This causes the valence electrons of the nitrogen of a free amino acid to be attracted to the carbon. Therefore, the nitrogen attacks the carboxyl carbon, breaking the CO double bond, and forms an unstable nitrocarbon bond with 2 protons, thereby conferring the nitrogen with a positive charge. The CO double bond then reforms, kicking out the hydroxyl group. The OH or the hydroxyl group, being electronegative, grabs the extra proton from nitrogen, neutralizing the nitrogen atom, thereby generating a molecule of water. What remains is a peptide bond with carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, and hydrogen. You'll also notice that peptides typically contain only 1 free alpha amino group and 1 free alpha carboxyl group, that is, at the opposite ends of the chain, that is, at the N and the C termini, respectively. These groups ionize as they do in free amino acids, although the ionization constants are different, because the oppositely charged groups are no longer linked to the same alpha carbon like in a single amino acid. So, what about the rest of them? Well, the alpha amino and alpha carboxyl groups of all non-terminal amino acids are covalently joined in the peptide bonds. Therefore, they do not ionize and do not contribute to the total acid-base behavior of peptides. However, the R groups or side chains of some amino acids can ionize, and in a peptide, these would contribute to the overall acid-base properties of the molecule.
For more videos and live lectures on the JEE, click on the subscribe button now.